done that, he's picked it up.
He's got him.
Got it! Got it! Yes!
Poor Tom.
Yes! Get it in
there! What have you got?
Get in there!
I am always upbeat about getting a bite. Even if I was sat here with three rods out, on that spot, wouldn't know what was happening on that spot. And I think it only takes one to pop along and nab him. When you know nothing's coming in.
Ignorance is bliss, isn't it?
No, it's Dan now. You alright, Dan?
Spring dog. Mate, I've been thinking about it after reading your thing. Why don't you two just scrub the underwater? We're already there. We know the lake now. We've seen where they're showing. We know where they're tucked up under the trees, which is obviously why we're not seeing them on the cameras. Why don't you two make a thinking tackle rather than sitting in the bin where you're staring at an empty screen?
I totally agree with you there, Dan.
Yeah, we're in.
Yeah? Right. Okay, crack on then, boys.
Shut up.
We are at Lac Luna, a 12-acre holiday venue just 2.5 hours from Calais. Crystal clear water surrounded in mature trees and overlooked by an old grain silo nicknamed Luna Towers hosts an impressive stock of classic looking old dark fish that wouldn't look out of place in an English syndicate, making it the perfect venue for the underwater project. With 11 swims in total and only 4 of them available, it was time for Spooner and I to pick the most likely looking areas.
Well, welcome to Peg 4 on Lac Luna. Swim choice has been made quite simple for me this time. Whilst the underwater filming's been going on, this is where I've actually been bivvied up. So I kind of feel like I could stake a claim on it. But what's better still is that all through the night last night, there was a lot of carp showing in here. And what I'm going to do is try to take you through my thought process on how I'd approach this. It's a typical commercial lake in France. I've got a relatively small swim in front of me. I'm essentially in a little bay, but none of that matters when you know there are carp present. So I'm going to get myself set up. The bivvy's already done. I'm going to get my rods ready, show you what I'm going to put out there, and hopefully we can hold one of the very special carp that I've already seen up on the wall.
So we've got a little bit of a different situation on our hands than normal on this one. Normally we'd be getting to a lake like this to fish a session like this, trying to figure out where the fish have been, where the fish are, what swims are available, what swims we might be able to fish. But because we've already been here for days on end and we know exactly where the fish are showing and what swims are free, we know exactly what to do. I'm in swim 9, which is actually in eye line of where we've been sitting for the underwater filming. And every single evening, we see fish show directly out in front of this swim, and that's exactly why I've come around here to fish. I'm gonna get my marker rod out, I'm gonna have a little flick around just to see what's out there, and then instead of fishing with a boat, which people normally do on this lake, I'm gonna get the throwing stick out, put out 4 or 5 kilos of boilies, and fish a spread of snowmen or pop-ups out there. And I think that's gonna work really well. It's very different to what people normally do here, and I know I'm on fish. I'm very excited. Right.
With my rods all set up, with my faithful spinners tied, it was into the boat to drop the first rig. I do like this sort of fishing. None of these spots are too far away. They are castable, but everyone that comes here pretty much goes to these similar zones in and around. So I think crashing a lead in and out to get it right is gonna really work against me in this situation. So I'm just gonna drift out. I'm using the outboard at the minute. Get close to the spot and just switch off and drift in. Lower it down. I'm gonna set a little trap. I'm just using some little mix of bait, bit of corn, bit of essential cell, bit of fruity smart liquid. I just want maximum attraction. My little hook bait sat amongst it.
Let's just sprint a little bit of bait down there first.
All it needed was a few small handfuls of bait, one last check of the hook before lowering the rig down directly on top. Then I opened the bail arm, and headed back to the swim in the straightest line possible, slowly letting the line out under the control of my finger. For the second rod, I decided to take the rig out on its own and lower it down by hand to make the whole process a bit easier. I placed a hand towel in the butt ring of the rod to help the line slowly feed off the reel with the bail arm open. This stops the line coiling off at its own speed and potentially creating tangles on the bank. I then lower the rig back down by hand, boat back, tighten the line up and set my clutches as tight as they go, and we're fishing. With two rods placed tightly up against the snags, I decided that that's all the rods I would need, as a third rod with another tight line to the far margin would only be detrimental and could also make it trickier to land the fish when I get a bite. When I was placing the left-hand rod down, the area was definitely cloudy, definite signs of carp feeding.
Well, how about that for a start? It's the rod that I said, where I'd seen that clouding up just this side of the spot. I knew there was fish over there, and that has been in the water for maybe an hour. And I was just down by the rod, luckily, and the bobbin just slammed up tight, so I could just literally, right next to it, be on it in a flash. And that is the importance with this sort of fishing. You can't leave your swim, because I'm fishing right up against some horrible woodwork, and being on them bites instantly is why you land them. You give them any time to get in there, you've kissed your chance goodbye. It started to go round to the right, so I'm keeping my tip nice and low, but he's actually started to kite back round out to the left. But I'm keeping it low. If he does go that way, hopefully he stays lower than the snags are in the water. A lot of them are just sort of overhangs as opposed to growing under the water. But I'm just gonna do everything I can to be sensible and put landing this fish in my favour. When he goes, he's so powerful.
Get in that net.
Yes, yes. Oh. Well, like I say, not totally orthodox, but we've got a fish in the net.
Yes!
Spoon has had one already. I haven't even got my rods out. It's actually quite handy, really. I'm going to go and... I'm gonna go and see what he's got.
He's a nice one.
It's lovely. How big do you reckon?
Well, 34-12.
Oh, it's bigger than that.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But you don't know what you're talking about, so.
No, true. When was the last time you caught a carp, though?
A long time ago.
But let's see how much you actually know.
Well, no, what are you saying?
39.6.
39, do you think that's nearly 40 pounds?
Yeah.
I've got so many 50s, these look small now.
Yeah, it's fair. Again, when was the last one?
34.
Is it?
34. 34.12. No, it's not 34.12, 34.8.
All right, well, I'll take it all back. You do know exactly what you're talking
that's
about.
That's £38. All right, you were close, all right?
Oh, great.
That's a nice fish, well done.
Lovely, thanks, mate.
Should we go watch some pictures?
Yeah, please.
Looking fantastic, that is. Well, you're not going to believe what the guy's got down there.
Go on.
I walked past him to get here. He's got a bivvy set up with screens in there, and he's got an underwater camera under the water to see what the fish are doing.
In the lake?
In the lake. He's only caught one.
How long has he been here?
5 days.
I've done an hour. Oh,
what an idiot he is.
What an idiot.
Apparently, right, he's fixed up a whole fishing tackle company. so he can get rich.
Yeah.
And then buy underwater cameras to help him catch carp, and he still can't catch them.
That is nothing short of embarrassing.
That's so embarrassing, isn't it?
Nice carp, Neil. Well done.
Cheers, dude.
So we're out and fishing, and it looks pretty good, if I'm honest. It really does. I got it up at the marker float, and I had to flick around, not too much, because I didn't want to scare the fish away, because I knew, obviously, that there were fish in the area. And all I found, really, was pretty flat 5 foot out there. Some areas are really hard, like gravel. Some areas are a little bit silty. But sort of just patchy out there, really. But it is very, very flat, 5 foot all the way across. What I've decided to do was stand at the front of the swim at the beginning, put out a load of boilies, maybe just over 3 kilos across 3 rods, and that's mainly in 2 certain areas. My left-hand rod has less bait on it, well to the left-hand side of the swim, sort of between here and where the point is, and I've probably put 0.5 kilo of bait around that one. That one's got a little snowman on it, and then I've got the rest of the baits, so probably 2.5 kilos, out towards the middle to the right hand side of the swim in a little bit of a diagonal, maybe 55 yards on my right hand rod all the way out to 65, sort of 70 yards on my middle rod. So any fish coming in from the right, I can intercept them in that big area of bait. It's probably 15, 20 yards long, that area of bait. And because I put it out with a throwing stick, there's just boilies everywhere, and I've got a little pop up and a snowman on that spot as well. So I'm pretty covered. The fish show in the evening, and actually, since I've had the rods out, a fish has showed as well. So it's feeling pretty good. I'm gonna sit back, relax, enjoy the evening, and hope I can catch a fish just slightly bigger than spooners. Yes, I can't believe we've got a carp on. It was actually what I thought was the least likely rod to go. It was a rod that was slightly shorter and to the right, probably 55 yards out on the edge of the bait, and it's the only rod with a yellow pop-up on it. Even in France, the pineapple pop-ups do the job. I can't believe it. I'm actually butting with this. I was thinking to myself, Spooner's got loads of fish on him over there. He's caught one straight away, and it's going to be a little bit slower over here, but we might catch ourselves a big one. So you never know, this might be the big one straight away. I'm a little bit worried that we've got so many snags down this right-hand side that it's going to end up doing me down there, but oh, one's just jumped right on my left-hand rod. Don't go in there, please, mate. Please don't go in there. Okay. Here he is. Come on. Come on. That is a beautiful way christening these new Kaizen rods. We've been testing them for a while, and these are the first ones we've had of the production. They've done a good job, haven't they? Thank you very much. Oh boy, I can't believe we've got one so quickly. Fat old French mirror. What a touch. What a touch.
The first thing to do was spread some more bait out across the area, as it looked like it could be a busy night. Then it was time to take a proper look at my first Lac Luna carp.
Well, there he is, the perfect way to set into the evening. So my right hand rod, and the only rod that I had out there on the pop-up, amongst probably 2 kilos of free offerings of boilies. And it turns out that this one, there was 35 pounds, 8 ounces, and it's called the Slug. Not a very inviting name, but a very inviting way to start. So thank you very much, our boy. This lake doesn't get fish much with boilies. So to get one that quickly, whilst throwing sticking out there probably only 2 hours ago, is a really good sign. You never know, we might be in for a bit of a hatful. Let's not run before we can walk though. This one will do nicely to start.
So I slipped the Slug back, then went back to my warm bed and snuggled down, blissfully unaware of what mayhem was about to ensue.
Oh, I've got a catfish. Oh, it's aggro. I hate catfish. Everywhere I go in the world, I catch catfish. Bye.
It wasn't long before the right-hand rod was away again. At least it was a carp this time.
This common is mental. What are you doing? Can we have you in the net? Yes, please. Lovely. It's actually a lovely little common. Obviously not what you come to France for, but see if I can get to have a look at him for you. Look, he's got no eye on that side at all. He's just absolutely blind. Nice little carp, thank you very much.
In the dead of the night, my right-hand rod was away once again, but this time, everything turned a little more serious.
I have no idea what the time is. It is the middle of the night. This fish is giving me grief. There's a lot of overhanging trees on the right-hand side. The fish is trying to get around them. Long old common. He's going in at this time. Yes! Oh, do you know what? I didn't actually think I was going to get that in.
With the carp safely in the sling, the action kept on coming.
There is a bigger mirror. That's what we like to see, boys. That's what we like to see. That's a bigger fish. That is a big fish.
Every time I thought the action had stopped, one of the rods would rattle off again.
Fat old mirror. Get in the net. Thank you, old boy. That is like a football, that one. Right. It does get light. I feel like we've been in the dark forever. But without first light, a little bag for the fish. And we've got another one on. Couldn't have dreamt the first night being this good, if I'm honest. There isn't that many carp in here, to be quite frank. So to have had, I don't know how many this is now. So I think this is the 6th carp. It's quite ridiculous. He's certainly one of the old ones. He's not a stocky. Look, it's carnage. Is that a carn? Right, let's have a look at him. That is my kind of carp. Big, round, boily-eating French mirror. A fish called Black Spot, and one I was actually looking at in the hut the other day thinking, I'd quite like to catch you. Lucky enough I did, 49 pounds, 2 ounces. And I've got to say, he's not even the biggest of the night. I caught him along with a 29 pound common, 43 mirror, a 35 mirror, and then the big one is literally sitting there in a sling ready to come out. Thank you very much, Tom Went. Has everyone last proper look at you? How about that? Oh, what a day. No better ways to spend a spring morning than sitting in a lake with a 54-pound, 12-ounce mirror in your arms. A fish called Mr. Sheen, one of the big ones of the lake, and one that loves boilies, apparently. Fishing boilies like that is such a great tactic, especially when it doesn't get used on a lake. This lake is predominantly fished by boats and particles, so it's something different, and it's working really, really well. And I'm probably getting boring talking about spinner rigs and pineapple pop-ups, but they just work so well everywhere. Whether you're fishing for 10 pounders in the UK or big old mirror carp like this in France, just work. Mwah. Thank you very much, old boy. You're going to be a 60 pounder very soon, let me tell you that. Last night, rig-wise, I went in with two different approaches, both of which have been very successful for me in the past when fishing with boilies. The first is a snowman setup, and actually I caught the biggest fish on that last night, even though it didn't do the most amount of bites, which was literally 7 inches of stiff hybrid that was steamed straight, a little bit of broken at the end so the braid is soft around where the hook is. The hook was a size 4 crank. It's got a tiny little bit of silicon on the back of the hook to keep it in place. And then a relatively long hair with a 15mm bottom bait and a 12mm pop-up on top of that. And that 15mm bottom bait is heavy enough just to sink that pop-up, so it sits hard on the bottom, and that way I'm not worried about it sitting up too high and the fish ignoring it, which is a little bit of a worry sometimes, and it's exactly why I didn't put a pop-up rig on all of the rods. But having said that, I did put a spinner rig on the right-hand rod, and that's the one that done me most of the bites. It might have been because the fish were coming from the right, but you can't ignore that I caught six fish, or five, I think five or six bites on a pop-up. So that's exactly what I'm going to go with tonight. I'm going to put it on all rods because I know it works. It's gravel out there, and I'm feeding boilies all over the place, so the pop-up seem to be working really well. I'm sure a lot of you have heard how I set this rig up already, but I'll talk you through it quickly. It's very, very simple. I tie a figure of eight loop in the end of the 15 pound boom. And the reason I use the 15 pound boom now is because it's a little bit softer, especially when I'm fishing it on the leg clip. I know that I'm definitely going to be presented out there and not have something that's really, really stiff. And that boom's probably about 7 inches long, and I tie that directly to the spinner swivel with a free turn blood. And then on the spinner swivel goes a size 4 crank Kamakura, a small green kicker over there, and then I slide a bait screw onto the back of the hook. And then I follow that up with a little hook bead, and the hook bead sits directly opposite the barb, so the bait will sit directly over the hook when it's sitting there as a pop-up. And that setup has caught me so many fish over the time that I just can't not cast one out when I get to the lake. And in this instance, I've fished them all with a running leg clip, and all I do is fish a normal leg clip, and I just pinch down the eye of the swivel that goes into the leg clip. I'll pinch it down a little bit and pull it in. If it still clicks, then I'll pull it back out and squeeze it down a little bit until it just doesn't click when it goes into the leg clip, and that means that it's pretty much running. You'll get a little bit of resistance as soon as the fish picks up the hook, and then it'll run free. And you can tell by the bites that it works really well. The fish run away, and on really pressured waters, it works much better than a normal leg clip setup.
Over in my swim, I had a very quiet night, but I found with a lot of snaggy swims in the past, they tend to spring into life as soon as the sun hits them. So first job was to get them all reset, check my hook points and hook baits, and get them back onto the spots ready for the chance of some more daytime action.
Well, same rod again, a very similar time to yesterday. I don't think it's a very big fish, but I did say you get a group of fish drift in and you're just gonna get a bite out of nowhere. I've been sat watching out there, seeing absolutely nothing. And then a little take and we're into another carp. Well, there we go, a very angry mirror carp that does not like the fact he's having his picture taken. But at 26 and a quarter is the result of staying solid and staying consistent with my approach, confident in the fact they would drift back in. Thankfully, that's exactly what happened.
Good evening, idiot.
Not sure who you're trying to get hold of there, mate. It's only me and you on these comms.
Yeah, that's you, I'm calling for you.
Oh, I get you. How are you, all right?
Yeah, I'm really, really good, funny enough. Sitting here, sun's shining, the rods are out for the evening, and I'm really confident. How are you feeling over there?
Yeah, I feel pretty good, mate. I had another one a little while ago, very similar bite time to yesterday. I'm just hoping that something slips up either this evening or through the night.
Very nice. So have you changed anything tonight, or are you you sticking to the plan?
The only thing I've changed, the rod that's done both bites, I've kept exactly the same. The other rod, because it's nearer the entrance of the bay, I've upped the amount of bait on it and done a little trail just into open water to see if it acts as a bit of a blocker and draws them under the snag.
Very saucy. That is very, very saucy. I've kept pretty much the same as last night, to be honest, but I had most of my bites on my right-hand rod, which was slightly shorter, slightly harder drop, and that was pretty much, it was the only one with the pop-up on, first of all, in the middle of the beginning of the night. So my middle rod, I've edged slightly closer to it, not too close to ruin its chances, but edged it slightly closer, slightly shorter, put a pop-up on that one as well, and then I've also put a pop-up on the left-hand rod as well. So spread a load of boilies out there, and I'm just hoping that last night wasn't the result of lots of fish being here, because no one was in the swim for a few days and now I've scared them off. So I'm just hoping that there's still some fish out there and we can do the same again tonight.
I think you will, mate. I think that's it's a very different feeding situation to what those fish are used to, and you've absolutely, as usual, made the most of it. You're going to get more. I'm positive of that.
But we'll see, Neil. Good luck anyway, and I'll catch up with you in a little while. Let me know.
Yeah, be lucky, dude. And the tightest of lines to you.
Okay, love you. Bye.
I'm all talk, aren't I? Saying I'm going to keep it all quiet, keep it down to two rods, but the plan has changed slightly. I've seen a fish roll off of, sort of in the open water near this left-hand margin, saw it roll once, and I thought, do you know what? I'm going to put a few 10 mil essential cell in that zone and see what happens. No more than, I reckon, 45 minutes later, a fish has showed right where I put the bait. So I thought, well, my thinking was I'm going to keep the lines down to a minimum so that it gives the carp a reason to come in. Now, those two lines are tight across to the far margin and the carp are still in here. So I think if I put a rig in position, I've got a little light lead to make minimal disturbance. I've got a naked choddy on there, so not very much at all. I can fish it super slack and it almost feels like I've got a third chance out there, but it's not affecting anything else. And if the carp are happy to be there now, they're only going to be happy with a little bit more bait on top of them, aren't they? So that's the plan. Naked chod in the zone. I'm going to catapult a few 10 millis over the top, slacking it all off, see what the night brings.
Days confused, I woke up still recovering from last night's action and fearing that the catfish were back on my bait.
Hoping this is a carp. Might not be. It might be. Coming up. It is a carp, that's good. That was weird. That was very strange. It came in like a catfish and all of a sudden it appeared and it went straight into the net. Quite a nice fish that. Let's put him into the sling. Have a little look at him in the morning.
Back in my swim, just as dawn was breaking, I'd had a strange occurrence on my right hand rod. Somehow, the fish had swam towards me without a bleep on the alarm. After picking up a lot of slack line, I was back in contact with the fish.
It's early in the morning, almost 6 o'clock, and we've had a bite for the first time on the right-hand rod. Come on. I'm desperate to get a picture of a carp with this big, I don't really know what it is. I think they're called, is it silo in the background? And I keep forgetting. So I need to land this fish and not forget my lovely photo.
Just when I thought that landing this fish and getting my picture was a done deal, I noticed the lead had slipped up the line, which meant I couldn't wind in anymore.
I have to hand line it in, I think, this last bit. Not ideal.
I slowly pulled the line in by hand, always allowing the fish to take it back if it made any lunges. After one last dive for the snags to my right, the fish was finally ready for the net.
Well, not quite an orthodox landing. I'm not sure how it's happened, but my line, or my lead, had got tangled up my line. So the last bit, just had to play it in by hand. Proper look at that common from this morning. 35 pound, a fish known as the pristine common, and you can see why. I am buzzing with this. I have just put the last of me bait out though, so I'm gonna do a fresh little mix, show you exactly what I'm using to nick these bites. And of course, Dovey's had another eventful night. So Dovey, it's over to you.
There it is. A lovely result from what was quite honestly a bit of a bizarre night fishing. I lost the carp early doors and then had a catfish, big 25 pounder, which was very unwelcome, I might add. Then I caught this one, then I had another catfish, and then I lost what was probably another catfish. And in between all of that, I had lots of weird liners and occurrences, which I think was lots of catfish bumping into my line. So I think the catfish have moved in, but even with that happening, this 35 pound mirror is more than good enough for being up all night. And a lovely way to start the morning.
Now, a lot of people.
Trying to walk backwards because that way I'm giving him no slack at all. Then when I do reel down, I walk back to the front of the swim. Oh, I was literally just about to make up a new mix of bait and show you what I've been using. That is going to have to wait. Oh, every part of my body is shaking. This type of fishing tests every bit of tackle to its limit. It's basically beaten. If I can just get him to come up between the rods, I think I can net him. Why would you make the last bit easy? Up you come. Look at that. He's nicked in the bottom lip. Yes! Get in! What a rush. You land any carp, whether it's a boring fight, you get it in the net, you're buzzing. But when you've landed one after a 20 minute epic, epic battle, I'm sorry, they just mean a bit more.
Yes, mate, I'm here.
I have just had the battle to end all battles with a rather large carp.
Go on, how big?
I reckon it's very close to 50 pound. I mean, I think it's been out recently at 49.2 or something.
Have you got black spot?
That's exactly what I've got.
No way. Massive well done. Do you know what, mate? I am going to reel in now anyway. I was going to give rest my swim for a little while. I'm going to come round and see it, if you don't mind. Be nice to see your face as well, to be honest. Yeah, boy. You're happy with him, aren't you?
I'm very happy with him. I was a bit envious of your capture list. I thought I want him, so I just had him.
Okay, I'm going to do that this way, and you can read it.
What did you have him at?
49 pounds, 2 or 4, I think.
Yeah, it's going to be bigger than that, I reckon.
You reckon?
You can't see it, can you? That is... 48.4.
Good.
Happy with that, are you?
Yeah.
I don't care. Now, you obviously all recognise this fish because Dovey only caught it yesterday, but that doesn't bother me a jot. It's a mega carp known as Black Spot. What's more interesting, I had a rod that was doing nothing. One rod had done both bites over little traps of bait, but I decided to really up the bait quantity on this rod, and it's done the last two bites. You never stop learning.
Look at him. Yes. Right, now where was I? Bait mix. So I've kept it nice and simple, gone for something nice and bright because springtime, I think the colour yellow is synonymous with spring fishing. When the fish wake up, it's an obvious colour for them to see. So you'll see from my mix just how bright I've gone. Starting off, we've got about 3/4 of a tin here of the good old sweet corn. Where you can get away with it, sometimes you've got different species in a lake. You might have a lot of tench, a lot of bream, and they can make it very difficult to fish with large quantities of sweet corn. But where you can get away with it, carp absolutely love the stuff. They can eat loads, digest it very quickly, and at this time of year, it's perfect. Adding into that, I put good helpings of 10ml essential cell. Keep them whole. I'm going to put some crushed boiling in a minute, but 2 big handfuls, maybe 3 actually, of essential cell. And then I've got some 15ml cell here. I don't actually want to put any whole ones of them out into the swim. I want a bit of crumb, a few different size chops. And what that's going to do, when you have crumb in a mix, carp are going to come in and out and feed. You're going to get bites. But by having crumb, you're keeping a legacy on the spot. You've got lots of little bits that are going to stay in the zone so that just when carp are in the area, they're used to there being food about. A few different sizes in. Just like sort of some less turns on the crusher, you get some bigger size chops than crumbing it all the way down. And then I'm going to mix that all up by hand just to get an idea how that looks. It's looking tasty, but I do want a bit more crumb. And what you see, the final bit I'm going to add to this is the fruit smart liquid. When you mix that in, when I'm out there dropping it with a boat, it's almost like dropping in almost like a ground bait ball, because it's a very fatty liquid. It floats up and down the water column. It suspends in the air. And I just feel that no matter what height, what depth of water those fish are coming in over the spot, they're going to get a whiff of that and can't help but have a little investigate. So, nice little glaze of the liquid, mix it all in. And it's worthwhile doing this sort of ahead of time, a couple of hours before you plan to put any out, because then that liquid will soak into the bait, the crumb will absorb some of it, and you just know that your spot is just leaking pure attraction all the time. Not again. There you go. That is very simple, super attractive. And when you marry that with a couple of grains of fake IB corn over the top on me spinner rig, you've just seen the result. Oh, that is good.
You'll notice that I'm fishing really slack lines, especially considering I'm fishing probably 65 yards out. And that is because on places like this, fish know you're there by your lines going out. They can see them quite clearly. And if you were to walk around now, you'd see lots of people with free rods, ping straight lines all the way out to their spot, probably a nylon. And that is very, very visible to the carp. And all I want to do is make myself as invisible as possible. And that's exactly what I'm doing here with a fluorocarbon. I've got 038, which is 18 pounds. It casts out there like a dream. It is very invisible in the water. So even if I did have tight lines out to the spot, you still wouldn't be able to see this. But because it's also much heavier than a normal nylon, I'm slackening off. And all of this is on the bottom from my tip all the way out to my rig. And that means that this area, all the way out in front of my swim, looks like there's no one fishing here. And that really makes a difference. It means that the fish are willing to come in and feed without any worry of getting caught.
Not long into dark, my right hand rod was away with a nice mirror. Not long after, I finally had a bite on the left hand rod, the one with a little choddy on it.
Just swim down. Cheers, mate.
And to complete a full house, just after sunrise, the middle rod was away. I didn't realise at the time, but the first fish was actually a recapture. The latest bite was just a small double, so I slipped them both back and was keen to have a look at the bigger one, caught from that new spot.
Now, I don't know what this fish is called, but I'm going to call it Perseverance. Just over 36 pound. It's come to that left-hand zone where I've seen fish show continually since we've been here, but hadn't managed to get a bite from. But I've kept solid. It's quite a soft area, so I've got that little choddy down there with a load of just 10 mil essential cell all around it. And this fella picked it up in the early hours of this morning. I reckon there's more to come from that zone as well. Oh, yes.
Now, when you come face to face with this sort of fishing situation that involves being locked up, giving the fish absolutely everything, it's imperative that you use not only a rig that's super strong, but one that you have complete faith in. For me, don't need telling, it's the spinner rig. I use it everywhere around the world, use it for just about everything. And whilst Dovey is also using the spinner rig, we are fishing them slightly differently. With Dovey putting a big spread of boilies out, it's natural to have a little pop up as he's fishing it. But myself, I'm lowering it from a boat. I'm being very, very accurate. I'm putting a lot of sweet corn and chopped and crushed boilie. So I prefer to have my hook laying flat with the two grains of IB slow sinking corn floating just above the top. And I'm pleased to say that so far, so good. I've had some epic battles with some big carp, and thankfully they've all found their way to the bottom of my landing net. Now, I saw a couple of fish show out to the left, so I wanted to put a rig out there, and the first thing I thought was, I'm gonna do exactly the same. But after having a little lead around, it was clear that not only was there a little bit of fresh silkweed growing, but it was also quite choddy, quite a soft, silty bottom. Not ideal, possible, but not ideal for that particular rig. Now, in this situation, I much prefer using the naked chod. It's a rig I probably don't use much anymore, but I've got great memories of using it. I've caught lots of fish with it. And when you're faced with that silkweed, I just think it's the ultimate presentation. So there you go, that's how I tie it. I've got 25 pound mouth trap to a size 4 Kamakura choddy. It's important when you've got a small lead to use the sharpest hook you possibly can. And for me, the Kamakura is an absolute no-brainer. Now, the way a naked chod works is once you cast it out, the rig's going to go to the back bead here. The lead, whilst it might sink down in a bit of silt, it might bury itself into the silkweed. But as long as you've balanced your rig properly, this is slowly going to come to settle over whatever's lying out there, and you know that you're always presented. Now, I didn't have a bite on it in the first 24 hours. I thought about moving it, but because there was still fish showing, I decided to persevere, and I'm glad I did. I moved the rig around a little bit more, and last night it all came good, and that 36 pounder you've just seen is the result of exactly that. There was a nice bed of boilie out there, no sweet corn this time, just 10 mil essential cell catapulted from the bank. This cast over the top, the winning hook bait, as always, is a little pop-up soaked in isotonic goo. It's probably been soaking for 3 or 4 months. The bait does its job by drawing the fish in and keeping them occupied, but when they get down and start feeding, that hook bait oozing attraction, I really believe, gets you the quickest possible bite.
This boilie fishing is something that I've really missed. I've done it awful lot as a kid, and as I've got older, the seagulls have got
progressively worse in the UK, which means you can't use one of these because they eat them all of the time. But when you come abroad, you can, because there isn't so many seagulls. Whenever I get the chance to do it, I do, because it's so successful. It really is. It's such an easy way of fishing. It's really simple because you don't need to clip up. You don't even really need to find any spots. All you need to do is cast out, make sure you get a good drop so you know you've presented, and then spray a load of boilies around it. It really is that simple. And the best thing about it is, it tends to pick out the bigger fish as well. So when you're fishing somewhere like this, it's got loads of big fish in it, you can catch yourself a hatful. They look lovely. Now, even though you find myself at the front of the swimming with throwing stick, I've actually cheated a little bit today because the wind's picked up. I haven't got any big baits because I didn't even know I was going to be fishing this trip. So I've nicked these 15 millers off Dan actually. And the wind's picked up and I can't really get them out to the spot. So I've cheated, I've gone out in the boat just halfway. I haven't gone over the spot directly in the boat because one, I didn't want to scare the fish away from the area. And two, I still really want that spread of boilies. It's really important that the fish are picking up a bait and having to move to go and get the next one instead of all of the bait being on a tiny little spot. So I've gone out halfway in the boat, spread the boilies everywhere. And I'm just coming back to shore as well. Got a few, fire a few out from here as well, just to make sure that I'm definitely getting that big spread. And then job's a good one. I'll put these out. The three rigs are ready to go. I'll wait for the evening to set in and hopefully catch some more big French mirrors.
Ah, oh, here he is.
I was looking over from there and I saw you sitting here with all of your mates.
On my own?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought I'd come over and bring you a beer.
Yeah. Well, I can open mine. Can you open yours?
No. No. Thank you.
Chin chin.
Cheers. What a lovely afternoon.
What a lovely afternoon. What a lovely trip.
Have you caught any more today, in the day?
I had a little one this morning, 18 and a half pounder.
I'll do.
Yeah.
Maybe the smallest one. No, actually, I caught the smallest one in the lake at the beginning.
Oh, one eye.
One eye.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
It's right though, isn't it? It's been good.
It has been really good, especially because I didn't think we were going to fish.
Mm.
To then walk away with a hatful, really, and some big ones.
Yeah, lovely. Every carp's been lovely as well. Done about one, I didn't actually see him on the bank.
He was still
really he lovely?
Nice. Yeah, blinding. Oh, I'm funny sometimes, you know what I mean? What? Even though you're happy with the amount of fish you've caught, what do you want to leave with?
10.
So I was thinking the same.
I want three more. It is greedy, but last night I've had bites on all three rods, so it's very doable. If they're in there again, I'll leave here with 10 fish.
Okay, fair.
That's what I feel.
Well, if they turn back up out in open water, I'll hope that I can catch three again.
If they turn up, you'll catch three.
But I'm a bit worried. If they turn up in front of me, it means they're not in front of you. Should we go for half the fish move out, I catch three, you catch three, and then we leave with 10 each in the morning?
Yeah, sure.
All right.
That works.
Deal.
Deal. Here's to tens.
We both came away from that chat super confident for the night ahead, and just as it got dark, I looked as if I would get at least one step closer to 10 fish.
Come on, my friend. Stay away.
After getting the fish away from the snags, it started to kite fast round to my right, past the snags and towards the end of the point. I needed to do something and do it quick.
I'm going to try and go out in the boat, I think. You ready, Kev? Can you grab a landing net? What I'm going to try and do is get round onto the point because I think I've got him clear of this snag. So if I can get round to the point, I can get back on firm ground and hopefully play him in from out there. Come on, lady luck, be smiling.
As I got close to the point, the plan seemed to be working perfectly, with the fish charging out into open water.
But this is the beauty of a lake where you're allowed to use boats. My line was going underneath that snag, and if I'd have tried to pull it back, the chances are I'd have just got cut off, because you never know what can be on a snag. So I've managed to get round onto the point, still attached to the fish. My line plucked off of the trees really easily. So I might have hooked him from peg four. I'm gonna land him from a peg, or hopefully land him from a peg that you can no longer fish. Come on, mate. Yes! Get in. Well, this fish for me is what carp fishing is all about. Teamwork. Without the help of the lads around me, I might not have landed that one. We didn't panic. With the help of Kev, we got out in the boat, Lewis covering everything from the bank, and we have got ourselves a very special 37 pounder. But it's only 9 o'clock. Could this be the start of a busy night? Let's hope so. And as I slipped him back, something looked strangely familiar about this fish. What is going on?
After hearing all about Spooner's epic battle with a 37 pounder, it was my turn, and the fish had exactly the same idea.
This fish has stripped me down to the left. The only worry is that it's exactly the same time of night as I've been getting the cats on this rod. So the chances are this is a catfish, but we'll play it like it's not one.
As my head torch lit it up, I could see that it was a carp, and it wasn't a small one either.
That's quite a big fish, that one. Yes! I've gone from being convinced that that was a catfish to having a big old mirror in my net. What a touch. Do you know the funny thing as well is that I've just heard Neil land one over there, and it was 37 pound. He's caught 8 and I've caught 7, but now I've caught 8 and I've caught a bigger one.
And after two quieter nights, normal service had resumed with another fish shortly after.
Come on, that's a common. Get in.
And then another, giving me the magic number 10.
Go, big long old mirror. Get in that. Let's thank you, please.
Cue the celebration dance.
Yes.
This is a very carpy morning. The mist is rolling off the surface. Got three fish in slings down there, one of which might be the big one, or it's certainly a big one. Got another fish on the go. Got a lovely brew on the go. Life is good. Hey! What a lovely way to end the trip. Really is.
Well, after that 37 pounder, it all went very quiet for me, so time to get reeled in, because it wasn't quiet for Dovey. Let's go and have a look.
What a ridiculous carp that is. I went into the final night hoping for 3 more fish. In fact, I caught 4, including this one that's 44 pounds 12 ounces, and one that the owner didn't actually know was even in here. A 35 pound mirror on first light, a 32 common in the middle of the night, and a big old mirror in the sling ready to look at after this.
I have loved my few days on here. I've enjoyed every moment and no more than this one right now. Mwah. That is a right old carp. He's lovely. I am buzzing with him. I can go back now. £49, 12 ounces, and I'm nearly falling over. This week couldn't have got any better, really. We didn't even think we were going to fish in the first place. We've got a hat full of big grey mirrors.
Well, you have.
And, you've had two and had them all six times. this is actually a really rare fish because Neil hasn't caught it twice this week. Look at that. What a lake and what a carp. Loved every minute. You're big, boy.
His little fin, wibbly.
Take my strong hand,
child.
Beautiful. Right, let's get him back and get on the road, eh, Neil?
Sounds like him. I don't really want to leave, but no. We've got families and that, haven't we?
Are we?
Yeah.
Well, morning.
Good work, mate. Yeah.
Cheers, the lads.
Yes, team.